What do you want in 2019? There's a lot of ways we can kind of answer that question, think about that question. I most often will track the things that I want on my Amazon wish list. I think I brought this up about New Year's last year. My Amazon wish list, if you don't know, Amazon has a section of their website where you can, if you see something you like, you can just click it and it goes straight into your wish list. You don't buy it, you just sit there and dream about what it would be like to actually own it. And I have ridiculous things in my list. I, believe it or not, have an Iron Man armor worth $2,000 sitting in an Amazon wish list. I'm that much of a nerd. I'm never gonna buy it because my wife would leave me, but I really like the look of it and I like to dream about having it. But this year, instead of just tell you what's on my wish list, and we all laugh at how silly and ridiculous I am, I thought I would bring other people in to be laughed at, because that's the Christian thing to do. So I'm going to tell you about what other people put on their wish lists in 2018. And before I do this, I want you to know these can be looked up right now on your phone on Amazon. I did not make these up. These are for sale, and people have dreamt about owning them. The first one is a 10 table for cats. There's a picture here. This is a scratch pad for your cat so that he can look like a DJ when he's doing it. Why you would want this? Who the person dreaming about owning this for their cat is, I don't know, but you should seek therapy. The next item that I saw people have favorited is grass flip-flops. So if you're the type of person who just, you love walking on grass and the ideas of normal human flip-flops disturbs you, he's the solution to your problem. We've got grass flip-flops so you can feel like you're walking on grass at all time. And the last one that I wanted to share with you, which I really can't believe that this is true, is bacon-flavored floss. So you can actually floss your teeth with a bacon-flavored floss. Now, floss is meant to clean your teeth. I can't imagine that whatever is imbued it with bacon flavoring is good for human teeth, but there you go. You can clean your teeth and feel like you're eating bacon at the same time. But all kidding aside, what do you want most in 2019? What would be on your wish list? If you could tally up the things that you're dreaming about, the things that you're hoping about in this next year, what would it be? Marshall Siegel, a commentator on the Bible, said, what would make your life feel great? What would it be, a spouse or children or more children? Would it be a better job, more pay, a better boss, more responsibility? Maybe it would be more time buried in your favorite reading list. Maybe watching football on Sundays or shopping without a budget. All those things are great, but the question is, are they great enough? Tonight we're looking at a question that Jesus asks his disciples. He says, what do you want me to do for you? And wrapped up in this story is this conversation between Jesus and some of his closest friends about what they want most. What is it that they are looking for Jesus to give them? And I love this story because there's so many accounts in the Bible that are really honest, and this is one of them, where these two guys come up and ask something quite unbelievable of Jesus. And these two particular people are called James and John. Now, they're really famous in the Bible. They're two of Jesus' closest friends. They were always with him whenever the biggest stuff happened. And Jesus actually himself nicknamed them the Sons of Thunder. And we're never told why Jesus decided to call them that in the Bible. But based on the kind of things that they ask him, I can only imagine it was because these two guys were just completely honest and bold all of the time. Because they ask something unbelievable. And as I think about this passage and I think about Jesus' question to them, and I think about where most of us in this room are today as we look towards 2019, and we're asking ourselves, what do we want? If God asked this question of us, what would we reply? I think about what this passage says and how I think God wants to use it tonight to open us up a little bit, to think about the things that we want most. So tonight we are going to listen to the question of the Master, the ambition of his disciples, and then the purpose of our Savior. So would you read this with me? We are in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. This is what it says. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you. And he said to them, what do you want me to do for you? And they said to him, grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory. And Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they said to him, "We are able." And Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. And Jesus called them to him and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." So the first thing I want to look at is the question of the master, the question that Jesus asks James and John. Have you ever had a conversation with a close friend or a spouse in which the question really isn't a question, but a statement? Right? They're asking you a question, and you know this is a trap because you're not really asking me a question. This is a statement. For example, sometimes someone, I don't know who it would be, might say to me, "Are you really going to wear that to church?" And what they really mean is, "You look like a moron and you should change." They're not really asking me a question. Or perhaps there might be an occasion, again, purely hypothetical, I don't know if it's ever really happened, where they say, "What are you going to do with the children this morning?" And what they really mean is, "If you let them watch TV for 2 hours, I'm going to come home and kill you." Now, again, purely hypothetical, never happened. It's not me at all. But these questions come up a lot in our lives. We have people in our lives who ask us questions, but they're not really asking us questions. They're trying to tell us something. Now, today we are looking at a moment in which Jesus asks a question, but he's not really asking a question. He's not really asking them a question. This is what he says. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you? What do you want me to do for you?" Now remember, Jesus never asks a question because there's something that he doesn't know. That's not how God operates, right? God has us figured out. He knows us better than we know ourselves. So if God is asking a question, if Jesus is asking us a question, it can't be because he doesn't know. For example, in Genesis, when God comes to find Adam and Eve after they have taken from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, he asks, "Where are you?" God knows where they are. But what God's doing is he's trying to expose Adam and Eve and get them to think about what they are doing, why they are doing it, so that they can see what he can see, so that they could see in that moment that something's gone wrong. Now, in this conversation, Jesus is asking a question because something has gone wrong in the mind of two of his really good friends. He is asking them a question because he wants them to look at themselves. James and John have come up to Jesus in the middle of moments of ministry when things are really busy. We're towards the end of Jesus' life, probably mere weeks away from the cross. And they say, "We want you to do for us whatever we ask." Now that's quite demanding to preempt your question by saying, "Whatever we're about to ask, we want you to agree to do it. Can you do that, Jesus?" And all he does is reply to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" It's the start of a new year this week, and we all have hopes and aspirations. We all have our wish lists, as we've already talked about. And if we are in church tonight, I can only assume that you think that God has answers to your questions, that you think that God in some way can give you some of the things that you're looking for. And so Jesus comes to ask us tonight the same question that he asks James and John. As we think about what we really want, he says, "What do you want me to do for you?" Now, when we read this story, we look at James and John, and we can really quickly vilify them and say, "Wow, those are really terrible guys coming up and demanding something like this from Jesus." But really, I don't think that they're any different than you or I. I think it looks really bold. But when it comes down to it, James and John were not more spiritual than you and I. They're not more clever than you and I. They're not more religious than you or I. These are just regular people who have found someone they think can answer the struggles in their life, and they want to come to him. And really, they're asking no different than we ask almost every time we come to God in prayer. God, would you do this for me? I want to ask you something, and I want to know, God, will you do it for me? If I ask this of you, God, would you be the one who could answer my question, who could give me what I need? They're trying to find out if God can really give them what they hope for. Now, inevitably this year, if you believe in God, you are going to ask him to do something for you. What do you want him to do? What is it that your heart longs for the most in this life? If we go back to this conversation James and John are having, it's really significant, the timing of it. Because we've just jumped in tonight, kind of in the middle of a moment, because what happens before this is really interesting. In chapter 8 of Mark, Jesus asks a question of his disciples. He says, who do you say that I am? And they kind of toss a few ideas around. And Jesus kind of presses them in again, and he says, no, I want to know what you think of me. Not what everybody else, what do you think of me? Who do you think I am? And Peter says something very famous now. He says, you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, you're right. So these disciples have just, very shortly before the conversation we're looking at tonight, they've understood Jesus is someone really important. When they call him the Christ, in their minds, they're thinking, this guy is going to be the king. He is going to be the one that comes in and eventually everyone will bow to him. This is the guy who's going to rescue us all. But what happens immediately after that first conversation, when Jesus says, you're right, I am the Christ, then he starts explaining what that means. He says, I'm going to die. When we reach Jerusalem, I'm going to be arrested, I'm going to suffer, I'm going to be persecuted, and eventually I'm going to be crucified. And every time Jesus says this, the disciples either flat out deny it. At one point, Peter even says, no, that can't be true. You shouldn't say stuff like that. So on the opposite end of the spectrum, they just get really confused. And Jesus says this 3 times to them. He says it immediately there. They walk a little bit more, they journey some more, and he says the same thing again. And every time, it's not a metaphor, it's not an analogy. He says, this is going to happen to me. And after the third time, immediately after the third time, James and John come and ask this question that we're looking at tonight. If we go to Mark 10:32, just a few verses before, they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. And they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And taking the 12, he began to tell them what was going to happen to him, saying, see, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles. They will mock him, they will spit on him, they will flog him and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise. And then immediately after Jesus finishes, James and John say, we want you to do whatever we ask for you. We want you to do whatever we ask of you. Now, it's a little awkward that Jesus is saying, I'm about to be arrested and killed. And immediately 2 friends go, yeah, cool. We want you to give us some stuff. They haven't listened. They haven't listened on the 3 times that Jesus has said this now. What being the Christ actually means. You see, James and John and the rest of the disciples have accepted who Jesus is, but they don't understand what his purpose is. Do you know it's entirely possible for you to accept who God is, to believe that there is a God, but not understand what his purpose for your life is? That in your heart, you can believe God is my Savior, but not understand what that means for your life. But Jesus, who knows their misunderstandings, decides to ask them a question. He doesn't show them anger. He doesn't show them frustration. He just says, what do you want, James and John? You know what I think Jesus is really asking them? I think he's saying, James and John, what do you think I am here for in your life? What do you think my purpose is? What is it you think I'm going to do for you? Because until James and John understand Jesus' purpose, they won't understand their own purpose. So long as we don't accurately see what Jesus came for, we won't understand what he is calling us to. Disciples follow their teacher and become like him. If James and John don't understand what their teacher Jesus is going to do and why he's going to do it, they won't understand what they're supposed to be doing as disciples. And their answer to the question demonstrates it. So let's look at the ambition of the disciples. There's a lot of talk these days about who the greatest of all time is. You may have heard it said, who is the GOAT? For the longest time, I had no idea that the GOAT meant greatest of all time. I just heard people saying, who is the GOAT? Who do you think the GOAT is? Do you think Michael Jordan is the GOAT? And I was like, I don't know, a GOAT? What are you talking about? But the greatest of all time. So is the greatest of all time Michael Jordan or LeBron James? Is the greatest of all time Tom Brady or Joe Montana? Who's the greatest Disney character? Who's the greatest nation on earth? Is it England or is it England? Who's the greatest superhero? Who's the greatest president? Who's the greatest writer? Who's the greatest musician? Who is the greatest actor, businessman? The list goes on and on. Who's the greatest among us? In every area of our culture, in every area of our world, we are looking for the ones who will stand out, who will be the greatest, who will do what no one else has ever done. And when it comes to the question of what James and John want, they want to be the greatest. In verse 37, it says, they said to him, grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory. And Jesus said to them, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized? James and John have failed to understand the purpose of Jesus. And so now they're failing to understand their own. They don't realize what it is Jesus has called them to do. And the evidence by what they ask for, because what they long for most in their heart is to be the greatest disciples. They know that Jesus is the king. He is going to Jerusalem, and when he gets there, he's going to become the king, and they want to be right there on top with him when that happens. They think that he is going to conquer the Romans, that he is going to kick out all of Israel's enemies. And when he becomes king, everything is going to be the way that they've ever dreamt of. Now again, it's really easy to vilify them and say, what a selfish thing to ask. And for sure, they ask something that's very twisted and broken. But again, I don't think it's that abnormal. I don't think that James and John are any more terrible than certainly me. I think there's lots of places in my life where I long to be great, that I want to have meaning and purpose, that I want to achieve something important. And when I get to the end of my life, I want to say, yeah, I achieved something meaningful and important. I want to be great too. The question is, what is true greatness? What does it mean to be great? That's where James and John have gone off the rails. They think that greatness means being on top of others. They think that greatness means sitting on thrones in glory. And the reason that they think that is because that's what everyone else around them thought greatness was. They looked at their world, and the people who were great around them, the people that were spoken about as being great, were people on thrones. People in palaces. But Jesus is bringing a different kind of greatness. He is coming to reshape our idea of what's valuable and what is great. And that's what Jesus is trying to point out to them. He says, you don't know what you're asking, James and John. You don't know what it is that you're actually asking me for. If you really want to be like me and sit with me in what my glory will be. Says, are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized? Kind of a cryptic response. And they didn't know what that meant at the time, despite the fact that Jesus has said three times what it means. Because the cup that he's going to drink is the cross. And the baptism that he's going to be baptized with is his death. And they don't understand that. They don't understand that the purpose of the Christ was not to come as some conquering king, more glorious than anyone else. It was to be low. In John 10:10, Jesus said, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, and I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The disciples liked the sound of that, and I like the sound of that. I want abundant life. I want the maximum, greatest life that I could possibly have. That sounds awesome. But what Jesus says immediately afterwards, immediately after following, "I've come to bring abundant life," he says, "I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." And just like the disciples, I miss the connection between those two things. The connection between abundant life and laying your life down. Jesus is absolutely here to be king, to reign, to be in glory. But the way he fulfills that, the way he accomplishes that for us, is radically different than what most of us tend to think glorious things are and what greatness is. Following Jesus doesn't often look like having everything go well and getting everything that we want. Being the greatest of all time isn't about being greater than everyone else. One commentator says about Jesus, "Even the greatest in this life only taste the cheap hors d'oeuvres of life and greatness. Stars are insanely enjoyed, celebrated, and worshipped, sometimes for 10, 25, even 100 years. But the most famous and successful people in this life are settling for the potato skins of greatness." When Jesus said that he came that you may have a full and abundant life, he wasn't promising less debt, longer vacations, more power in the company. His promise is real, and following him will satisfy us beyond our wildest imaginations, but it won't look like so much other so-called greatness around us. Here's the point that Jesus is about to get to with his disciples. True greatness is going to cost you your ambition for yourself. Because true greatness is ambition for others. True greatness is going to cost you your ambition for yourself, because true greatness is found in having ambition for others, for something other than yourself. Most of the time in this life, if not all of the time, what we want is a barrier to what God wants to do in our lives. We think like James and John, and we think we know what greatness looks like and what God's design for our life should be. But the problem is God comes in to give us something else. And so just like James and John and the rest of the disciples, when God shows up and tells us what he is here to do, we end up rejecting it, we end up struggling against it, we end up flat out denying it, because it doesn't look like what we thought greatness looked like. He's not the savior that we thought he should be. We want our meaning and purpose so deeply in our lives that what we do is we come to Jesus, and when he asks us that question of what do you want, instead of asking him what he wants, we say, "Jesus, we want what they have. We want what all the great people in this world have. We want comfort and security. We want peace." And all those things are good things to ask for. Jesus' point is that not that it's bad to ask for these things in our lives, but that if we are asking for those things without asking Jesus first, "What do you want for our lives?" then we have put those things in front of Jesus, and he's no longer king. You see that? That if we come to Jesus and we preempt him and say, "We want you to give us whatever we ask," we're not treating him as our king. We're just treating him as some vehicle to get what we want. God and Jesus have become just something that we use to get what we want. We plead with God, "Help me get my finances to a comfortable place. Help me get my relationships to a comfortable place. I don't want hardship and challenge and conflict and doubt. I want security and simplicity, a stress-free environment. Help me get things together." The problem is what God wants to do in us, the greatness he wants to bring us. Sometimes it requires hardship and discomfort. Now Jesus looks at his friends and their misunderstanding and their confusion, and he loves them. He wants his friends to see that the way in the kingdom to glory is sacrifice and service. If we want to follow true, if we want to get true greatness, then we've got to follow in the footsteps of true greatness. If we want to be disciples, we've got to follow our teacher. And if we want to find our purpose, we've got to see the purpose of the Savior. Jesus called to them and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them, but it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus makes it plain that the greatness that he's offering is not the greatness of this world. His disciples are going to be different. Essentially, what Jesus says to them is, don't chase what everybody else is chasing, James and John. Don't fall into the trap of thinking that that's what greatness is. That is the potato skins of greatness, James and John. True greatness is being on the bottom. True greatness is upside down. It's becoming low, making yourself a servant. Why is greatness being on the bottom? Why does Jesus think that the greatest things that we can do is to make ourselves a slave of all? Because that's the greatness that God displays. That's what God did for us. That's how God made himself great in our eyes, was to come and to empty himself and to serve us. Marshall Siegel, a Christian writer that I mentioned earlier, says, "When the greatest greatness came into our world, he was born in obscurity and laid in a feeding trough. He walked from town to town without a home, without a place to stay. He made some headlines with his message and miracles, but he made many more enemies. And when the Son of God came, calling lowly fishermen to be his disciples, he kneeled and washed their filthy, undeserving feet. The King of Kings, the greatest of all time, humbled himself to the point of death, even the most shameful, painful kind of death that there was. True greatness lost his life in love for us." Our lives should be an emulation of that love. The Christian life should be a demonstration of the one who did not seek glory among men. God made himself nothing. He emptied himself. And the heartbeat of why he did that is his unending, unbreakable love for me and you. He wanted to serve us. He wanted to debase himself, to lower himself, to bring himself to the lowest possible point, because he loved me and he loved you. That's what true greatness looked like. That is the purpose of our Savior. Jesus was who James and John thought he was, but he did not act the way that they thought he should. Their rescue and redemption did not come from a conquering warrior who threw the gates of Jerusalem open. It came from a crucified servant who hung on a cross, praying for the people who nailed him to it. When we start making our lists of what we want God to do in 2019, dare we pray that he would make us like Jesus? Would we have the courage to say to God, what we want most, in the depths of our heart, what we long for, is not glory, but service. We want to look like you, Jesus. Dare we ask that he might make us better, more faithful servants? Dare we ask that he would humble us to see others as better than ourselves, not just in theory, but in practice? Because I could quote to you all day Philippians 2 about making others better than myself, but do I really do it? Do I really go to Jesus and say, I have to be like that, Lord, because that is what you are like? I hope that I can find the courage to pray for that this year. Because sometimes I spend my requests on the same kind of frivolous things that James and John asked for in that moment. Now, I am really thankful to be in a church that challenges me to be courageous and pray to be like that. To say that I want to be a servant of all. That's the heartbeat of our church, I think. I think that because I come to church and I see people who serve others all the time. People in our church who we might not take great notice of, who we might not see, but who I think in the eyes of God are great. People like Catherine Tilley, who took 40 hours out of her work week to go and paint a mural at Markland for kids who are there and don't have a lot of people that care about them. People like the regular serving staff at our church who are involved in children's ministry, people who care for our kids, people who run programs throughout the week to love others, people who lead care groups in our midst to care for the widows and the orphans, for those who are broken, those who are struggling with anxiety and depression. Those families amongst us who are finding amazing ways to love their neighbors, to go out in their neighborhoods and be a chapel on their street. People who I've seen who this Christmas have went to the homes of widows, people who've lost loved ones, and decorated their houses for Christmas just because they wanted to find a way to love their neighbors who'd lost someone. I see people who gave sacrificially over the course of our campaign this last month and raised almost three times more than what our original goal was. Giving generously and sacrificially because they believe in the work of God in the earth. People like Amanda Good, who some of us might not have even known her name a few weeks ago, but now we know that one of our own has been laying down her life for Rwandan boys to love them so that they can see a glimpse of Jesus. Church, this is the greatness that Jesus offers to everyone in this room tonight. He doesn't hold it back. He doesn't say, well, you don't understand and you don't get it, so you don't get to be great. Do you notice that what he says to James and John, even in their misunderstanding and their foolishness, he says, you are going to drink the cup that I drink. You are going to be with me. Because my disciples are going to be the people who lay their lives down for others, just as I am. He didn't turn James and John away despite their misunderstanding, he invited them to follow in his footsteps. And that's what he invites us to do tonight. So I'll leave you once more with the words of Marshall Siegel, who said, if you aspire to be great, give yourself to the small, mundane, easily overlooked needs around you. God died that you might live. And that life, your new blood-bought, forgiven, grace-filled life, was meant to be great. It was meant to be laid down in love for others. Would you pray with me? Father, the greatness that you showed us, it doesn't look like what most of us would call great. Lord, I confess in my life, there's so many times that I've come to you seeking a greatness that you have not offered for something that is less than what you have offered. And God, I pray for all of us in this room, I pray for this church tonight, Lord, that this year we would have the courage to pray to be like you, to be like the Son of Man who came not to be served, but to serve, and to lay his life down in love for others. Lord, we love you and pray this in Jesus' name.